unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and he shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. My brothers and sisters, as we think about this fourth Sunday of 2020, the last Sunday of the year, we would like to use for a thought, God has a plan for your life. We would like to use for a thought that God has a plan for your life. One of the most fascinating of things to do in life is to board an airplane and take a flight. We know that due to COVID, air travel has been restricted and also discouraged. Yet many people accept the risk of going on a plane and flying, as we say, the friendly skies. And no matter your choice of airline, we must keep in mind that no pilot leaves the airport without a flight plan. I was reading a blog entitled, Flight Planner for Pilots, Why Is It Necessary? And in this blog, and I'm reading a quote, it says, Flight plans are helpful for assessing and making allowances for the following during a flight. And it categorized three areas when it came to a flight plan. Number one, when the pilot looks at the plan, they want to take in consideration weather and wind conditions. And then secondly, they want to know about the amount of fuel needed in relation to the aircraft weight and the distance that will be traveled. And then third and lastly, regarding the flight plan, the pilot needs to understand the air traffic control and the navigating instructions and airway safety tips. And it tells us that no pilot should ever enter an airport, aboard an airplane, or sit in a cockpit and take off on an airplane without a flight plan. You know, so many of us take off in life and we have no plan. We have no purpose and no goals. Some of us might remember that famous boxer by the name of Mike Tyson who said, everybody has a plan until they get hit in the mouth. It's a great quote, and it caused me to think about what happens when you don't have a plan and you still get hit in the mouth. See, everybody needs a plan. If you're working on a business concept, you need a five-step business plan. If you're thinking about retirement, you need a retirement plan. If you're building or buying a house, you'll look at a building plan. If you go into any of life's significant matters, such as a wedding, you need wedding plans, or vacation plan, or health insurance plan. Some of us need an exercise plan and a financial plan. Everything you do in this life involves a plan. There's an expression that says, when you fail to plan, you plan to fail. Every age group needs a plan because a plan keeps you focused. It keeps you grounded. It does not matter whether it's one goal or a few goals or 10 goals. A plan also keeps you motivated, keeps you stirred up and fired up. A plan helps you with your expectations and your anticipation and revelation and motivation. And when your plan includes the Lord, you know, everybody needs a plan that includes the Lord. A plan that where the Lord also includes you and accepts you and uses you according to his plan. It reminded me of that great trumpeter, Louis Armstrong, who sang, "I think to myself, what a wonderful world. When your plan is about the Lord's plan, then you'll have hope in the plan. You'll have peace in your plan. You'll have joy in your plan. You'll have love in your plan. But more importantly, you'll have Jesus in your plan." When we read this word in Luke 1 and 28, it said the angel came in unto her and said, "Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women." When we revisit not only the birth narrative of Jesus and recount the story of Mary's pregnancy, can't have one without the other, it's really about a plan for human life. There was something about this plan that caused Mary to stand out among other women. We hear about her virgin status. She was neither sexually active nor slept around. As a virgin, we also know that it's not only about being non-sexually active, but it also meant that she was a young woman. Her specific age is debatable, but seems clear that she was a teenager. And while our cultures do not encourage marriage as a teenager, and should not, there was a time, and many of you can recall, a time that without question, when folk got married at the ages of 15 and even 16 years of age, they would start a family. Notice that this is not instruction, young people, or encouragement. I'm only providing historical and cultural insight. If you are a teenager, what is important for you to underscore as we think about Mary being a teenager is the fact that throughout the Bible, young people and young adults, that God was using them for greater works. This message is not about that, but we hope to come back to it. You need to read from Genesis through Revelation of all the young people and the children and the young adults, children ages and teenagers that were involved being used by God. It would be foolish to think that Mary was the only virgin. Nevertheless, the angel Gabriel made a visitation telling her that thou art highly favored, which is really less about Mary and more about God's choosing of her. Sometimes we get this thing backwards, where there are traditions that lift up Mary as if she has a God-like status. The teachings of Theocritus that Mary is the mother of God is not a healthy teaching. She's esteemed among women, but she's not esteemed among God. She was a woman who God decided to choose. Mary did not choose God in this fashion, but she was chosen by God. And any time the Lord shows high favor, it's less about the person and more about God. Too many of us as Christians keep believing that life is more about us than it is the Lord. We did not choose God. We did not choose the church. We did not choose the faith. We did not choose you. You may have come by a number of ways. Maybe you were raised in the church. Maybe you stumbled into the church. Maybe you guessed your way into the church or bought your way into the church or forced your way in the church. But always remember that we never chose God first, but he first chose us. In short, we all are not highly favored like Mary. Mary was blessed. And the word said, but blessed among women. There are times that God shows high favor, but not for the benefit of the person, Because being highly favored is about God's plan and purpose beyond one's personal life. In other words, when God gives you special favor or high favor, it is not for you, but in order to be a service for the Lord. So if some people have high favor, where does this lead the rest of us? See, highly favored does not mean that other women and other men and other people had no favor. Solomon tells us in Proverbs 8:35, "For whoso findeth me findeth life and shall obtain favor of the Lord." See, God's favor is not about what God does for you or gives you, but about how God accepts you in spite of you. How God accepts us in spite of us. How God receives you and uses you and uses us anyway. What I learned in life, that some favor is better than no favor at all. Some of you remember the story of when Esau sold his birthright. Isaac blessed Jacob with high favor. But when Esau pleaded with his father, he said, "Do you have any blessing for me?" And his father was still able to give him something. When Sarah used her handmaiden Hagar to give her husband a child, the firstborn who was Ishmael, Sarah became mad and angry with Hagar and even put her out of the house. And then Ishmael would not be highly favored like Isaac. But yet God turned around and still blessed Hagar and still blessed Ishmael. We must realize that just because you are not first in line does not mean that you are not in line. Remember that some favor is better than no favor at all. Some blessing is better than no blessing at all. Some money is better than no money at all. Some house is better than no house at all. Something to put on is better than not having nothing to put on at all. Thank God that regardless of the level of favor and the level of blessings that he gives us, he makes sure that the sun shines on the just and the unjust. The rain falls on the just and the unjust. In other words, God has not forgotten about you. If we look at Luke 1 and verses 29 and 30, when Mary saw him, Gabriel, the angel, she was troubled at his saying and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, "Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God." Although God accepted Mary and placed her in a unique position, God's plan did not keep her from having a troubled mind. See, she had a plan for her life, and God had a plan for her life. And whether you realize it or not, sometimes your plan or our plan or my plan does not run congruent. They don't go hand in hand. They're not together with God's plans. Sometimes we gloss over the text when we read the scripture. We're quick to look at Mary holding a baby in a manger without seeing that Mary was really in trauma. Can you imagine God intruding your life and changing your plan? She questioned and wondered, you know, what was God doing not only in her life, but with her life? Some translations say that she was greatly troubled. In modern terms, we might conclude that Mary maybe even had some mental anguish. The Montgomery New Testament stated that she was agitated at the words of God. God has this way of coming into our lives. We call it divine intervention. Sometimes we call it acts of God's providence. God comes in and without our permission, God comes in and allows some things. God changes things. God rearranges things and removes and adds things without our permission. God's word that enters into us, like Mary, can create a troubled mind where you begin to think about your own mortality. God's word comes in, not for aggravation, but agitation. Some of you know what it means to put your clothing inside of a washing machine. A washing machine that is designed to agitate. The machine is turned on. You put detergent inside of the machine. You have your clothing inside of the machine. And as the spin cycle rotates and the water comes in and reverses and it shakes here, yonder, and there, it loosens the dirt, it loosens the soil and debris, and the cleaning process takes place. So when the word of God comes in our lives, not to aggravate and frustrate, but to agitate, the word of God loosens the filth inside of us. The word of God loosens the ugliness inside of us. The word of God loosens the selfishness inside of us. And it begins this justifying and this sanctifying and this perfecting grace inside of us. It begins this cleansing and this washing and this sanctifying and this purifying that is inside of you. And every now and again, God's word should agitate you. Every now and again, God's word ought to make you feel troubled in your mind and troubled in your spirit and troubled in your soul. Every now and again, God's word ought to make you feel uncomfortable. It ought to make you feel like not being your old self. See, after being troubled, it became evident that Gabriel saw the fear that was inside of Mary. He confirms her fear by saying, "Fear not." Just because you and I are God's children does not mean that we won't have moments of fear. So many people are living in fear because of what we've seen in 2020. I was watching a television show called Ninja Nun. And the ninja nun was trying to use on this episode her power to walk through the middle of a 20-foot concrete wall. She used her power to enter and got halfway through the wall. And because of fear, she froze up, not making it all the way through. Sometimes fear will cause you to not make it all the way through. Sometimes fear would make you want to give up. Sometimes fear would make you want to drop your plan and change your plan. Sometimes fear would make you freeze up and make you stop in the middle. But the ninja nun had a friend outside of the wall. A friend that was speaking to her through an earpiece who said, "Keep on going." And if you're living in fear, I'm reminded of 2 Timothy 1:7. For God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Sometimes you need somebody outside of yourself. You need somebody outside of the wall. You need somebody that can tell you how to keep on going when you don't feel like going. Too many of us are living in fear of the unknown. Too many of us are living in fear, and you have God's favor. Too many of us are living in fear of the virus and living in fear of the vaccine and living in fear of the future. And you need somebody outside of your wall of fear. You need somebody outside of your wall of sickness. You need somebody outside of your wall of financial debts. You need somebody outside of your wall of hardships. You need somebody outside of your wall and your trials and your tribulations. You need somebody that can tell you outside of the wall, that can speak to you that you gotta keep on going. You need somebody to tell you to keep on moving. You need somebody to tell you sometimes to keep on pressing. You need somebody sometimes to tell you to keep on praying, to keep on studying. Don't die. on living, Gabriel tells Mary another interesting thing about this plan of God. This last verse, Mary, behold, the angel tells her that thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth the son and shall call his name Jesus. The angel had to explain the plan to Mary that she would conceive and give birth to a child. But I love what Mary does. Even though God gives God's plan, Mary still took time to question this foolishness by saying, how can I get pregnant when I have not known a man? See, my brothers and sisters, when you realize God's plan is coming upon your life, it's all right to have a dialogue with God. It's all right to have a little talk with Jesus. It's all right to raise some questions about what God intends to do in your life. So Mary is saying, how can I get pregnant when I've not known a man? How can I get pregnant when this is nowhere on my mind? This is not where my goals are. In fact, Gabriel, this is not even my plan. My plan for my life and the plan for my future, I need to talk to somebody that had a plan, but your plan did not work out. I need to speak to somebody that had everything laid out, everything mapped out, and everything paid for, and everything worked out. I need to talk to somebody that was heading in a different direction. I need to speak to somebody that had everything planned out and then the plan was changed. Well, in her case, Gabriel had to explain to her this divine experience. Somebody might say a divine experiment. This scientific, biological, medical breakthrough that was about to happen to Mary in her life. Gabriel said, if I can just play with this a little bit, Mary, you will not find out what happened to you on modern science. Mary, you can't go on a Google search and see what God is about to do. See, everything you won't find in the book, everything you won't find online, when God gets ready to do something miraculous in your life, Mary, you won't find this in the historical record. You won't learn about it in a magazine. You won't find it in current research for what God is about to do in your life. Some of us have given up on God because you think you've seen all that God can do in your life. No, you've not seen all that God can do. All I can do, Mary, as Gabriel talks to her and elaborates and tells her that the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. We learn, Mary, that while we may not understand it all, we do know that every plan has a conception stage. It has a beginning stage. It has an embryonic stage. It has an incubation stage. And whenever you've been chosen as a child of God, whenever you've been accepted by God, whenever you've been picked out by God, never underestimate when the Holy Ghost is involved. Never underestimate what God can do in your life. Never underestimate what God will do through your life. Never underestimate what God will do in your life and what God is able to do in your life. Finally, there's another aspect of working with a plan, and that is you must be receptive to what God does in your life. The first one is that a plan has to be conceived, and then secondly, you have to be receptive to the plan. It's so important to know that it does seem that Mary had a choice before she made a decision. Don't be too quick to assume that just because God was in the plan, that Mary accepted the plan. But also realize that God did not force Mary either. See, after she questioned God about his plan and then struggled with her own plan, the angel had to answer her question about what was going on in her life. What type of salutation was this? What type of intrusion was this? What type of greeting was this? And Mary responded in verse 38, "Behold, the handmaiden of the Lord." In other words, "Lord, here I am. Be it unto me according to thy word." And get this, after Mary consented to the Lord, the angel departed from her. See, Mary, this teenager, this youthful individual, this child that some folk would have called her, in essence said, "Lord, whatever you need me to do," I love that. I love working with folk that when you're on a project or on a team working together, they can easily say, "Whatever you need me to do." See, this is the problem. Many of us can't say, "Lord, whatever you need me to do." But we want God to do everything for us. Many of us view our plan greater than God's plan. Many of us have no plan and deny God's plan. Many of us are quick to follow everybody else's plan except for God's plan. But Mary is saying, "Lord, whatever you need me to do." I haven't been there before. I've not had a child before. I don't know what you will do in my life, but whatever you need me to do, whatever you need me to be, whatever you need my body for, whatever you need my mind for, whatever you need my spirit for, as long as it's your word, let it happen, Lord. I need to speak to some folk that have a plan, but then gave your life over to God's plan. There's a song that used to say that I'm available to you. You might remember the song. "My will I give to you. I'll do what you say do. Use me, Lord. Use me, Lord, to show someone the way and enable me to say." The song went on to say that my storage is empty and I'm available to you. But I love this next stanza. "Now I'm giving back to you all the tools you gave to me. I give you back my hands. I give you back my ears. I give you back my voice. And I give you back my eyes. So you can use me, Lord, use me as you please. I've emptied out of my cup so that you can fill it up. Now I'm free." There's nothing like being free in the Lord. "I just want to be more available to you. If I can testify just for a moment, I have no doubt that if I kept my own plan in life, that everything would have worked out fine. I have no doubt that if I had stayed in the military and not have lost my life, that I would have done well serving in the military. I have no doubt that if I had worked in the corporate, that I would have done well in corporate. I have no doubt that if I had owned my own business, that I would have been wealthy, I would have retired, and I would have been on Easy Street before 50 years old. But there's something about taking your plans and giving it over to the master's plans. There's something about taking your plan and giving it over to Jesus' plan. There's something about taking your plans and then turning it over to the Lord's plans." I need to speak to somebody that had your own plans. I need to speak to somebody that had no plan, but you found